Hello,
welcome to the EPG Pathshala, the e-postgraduate Pathshala. This is the course Introduction to Linguistics, and the module that we will listen to today is called Rule-Governed Creativity in Language. My name is Amrita Valli. I am a professor at the English and Foreign Languages University at Hyderabad. We are accustomed in ordinary life to think of creativity as something special. It's not something that we associate with our usual, everyday, ordinary life. So we think of some professions or some people as creative. We say that a particular musician or a dancer or an artist is creative. We talk of the arts as creative, whether they are the performing arts of music and dance, or the visual arts of sculpture and painting, or the visual narrative of cinema. We think of these as creative professions, creative arts. On occasion, we can also think of science as creative, especially if somebody's made a good breakthrough in research, then we say, oh, that is a really creative breakthrough in scientific research. We also extend the idea of creativity to the crafts. So that is why we have the collocation arts and crafts. And so sometimes we ask that the crafts be included in the school curriculum in order to include creativity in the educational system. Now today, the kind of creativity that I'm going to talk about is not this kind of creativity. We do not think as linguists of creativity as something separated from ordinary life. We do not oppose it to what we do every day, or what we do usually. It is not a special cultural construct. We think of ordinary language use as fundamentally creative. It's a kind of creativity that we will show you. We can call it rule-governed creativity. Linguistics, as we see it today, is about rule-governed creativity in ordinary language use. This view of language as fundamentally creative is opposed to a scholarly opinion which prevailed in the United States of America in about the 1960s, at the time when Chomsky started his new ideas about linguistics, which thought of language as fundamentally a learned behavior, a response to stimuli which had been learned by conditioning. In direct contradiction to this view of language as learned behavior, because you repeatedly associate certain responses with certain stimuli, Chomsky wrote, "The central fact to which any significant linguistic theory must address itself is this. A mature speaker can produce a new sentence of his language on the appropriate occasion, and other speakers can understand it immediately, although it is equally new to them. Most of our linguistic experience is with new sentences." Now, what does Chomsky mean by saying that most of our linguistic experience is with new sentences? Because when you and I speak to each other and listen to each other, we don't get the idea that we are doing something very new. To understand this idea, we have to understand what the earlier opinion about how we speak a sentence was. As I mentioned earlier, in the era of American linguistics before Chomsky, language was thought to be a conditioned form of behavior. That means we were taught to only utter those sentences that we had somehow already heard and learned. So On that view, what we say is just what we've already heard said before. There is a sameness about our sentences. We say the same things in the same situations. The situation is the stimulus, and what we say is the response. So a stimulus is associated with a response, and so there is the sameness about the stimulus and the response that it elicits. There's nothing new. If a stimulus and response pair occurs often enough in our experience, we learn to respond in that way to that stimulus. This was the theory of how language is learned and how language occurs in real life, how we speak in real life. This stimulus-response-reinforcement model of language learning basically arose from experimentations in the laboratory with laboratory animals that learned to do tasks that were set for them by the human experimenters. So you must have heard about, for example, the Pavlovian dog experiments. In those experiments, a dog naturally salivates when it sees food. So first you get the dog to salivate at the sight of meat. Then you start ringing a bell whenever you give it food or show it meat. The dog is at first salivating at the sight of the food. But because you repeatedly ring a bell at the same time, the dog transfers its response of salivation to the bell. So it learns to salivate when you ring a bell. This was the Pavlovian experiment. In America, they taught rats to run a maze in order to seek for food. And they taught pigeons to peck at a correctly color-coded button rather than the wrong color button. So if you had a blue and a yellow button, for example, and the pigeon picked at the blue food, you gave it food, it pecked at the yellow button, you did not give it food. If you did this often enough, the pigeon learned that if it pecked at the blue button, it would get food. And again, this was stimulus, response, reinforcement, reward, learning. Now notice that in this kind of learning, there is no talk of any kind of learning that is particular to a species or natural to a species. In our talk about linguistics, we've talked about language as being natural to human beings. What is natural to pigeons? Their homing instinct, for example. And today, if you look at the research done on pigeons, we are trying to explain how pigeons can find their way home. But the research that we're talking about in the 1950s, 1960s, in the behaviorist paradigm of psychology and language learning, I suppose, did not address the question of what a particular species naturally learned. The learning tasks which were set were artificial. They were conceptualized by another species, and they were set for these other species to learn. That's one thing I would like to say about this. The other thing I'd like to say is that today we talk about even rats having a mental map, which is how they learned to learn the run the maze. Earlier it was thought that rats learned to learn to run a maze by looking at each fork in the maze and choosing the right one. But today, animal scientists have reason to believe that the rats built up a mental map. In any case, in the 1960s, the dominant mode of theorization in the USA about behavior and learning was from the behaviorist school of psychology. And in 1957, a very important event occurred. B.F. Skinner, the leading behaviorist psychologist, published a book called Verbal Behavior, which was the product of about 20 years of work. And this book tried to extend in a very systematic way all the theorization of stimulus response reinforcement learning to the everyday use of language by human beings. Now, in 1959, Chomsky published his review of Skinner's verbal behavior. That review is now a classic. I would recommend that you read both. As I reread them over the years, I admire both of them, because both of them are very serious researchers. And yet, of course, I think Chomsky managed to show that Skinner was fundamentally mistaken in his view of language. What Chomsky showed was that the functional analysis of verbal behavior attempted by Skinner, which tries to map input, that is, the stimulus, directly to the output, that is, the behavior of an organism, is fundamentally deficient because it doesn't take the organism itself into account. Okay? So the input is, two buttons which are color-coded in different ways. The output is the pigeon pecking. The pigeon itself is nowhere in the theory. Now, the reason the pigeon itself is nowhere in the theory is that how the pigeon processes what we are doing to it and how it decides what to do, and neither of them is directly observable. They are in the pigeon's mind. And behaviorism had a view of science that science concerns itself only with what is observable. This is not a view of science that is universally accepted. But in those days, the idea was that science confines itself to the observable. The mind is not directly observable. The mind is observable only through behavior. And so, let us not talk about how the pigeon sees the input and how it decides what to do. Let us only talk about what we do and what the pigeon does. That was the idea. Chomsky pointed out that the theory pays a price for excluding the organism from its theorization. And the price it pays, Chomsky showed in his review of B.F. Skinner's verbal behavior, is that the theory can explain only the most trivial behavior, or if it tries to explain slightly more complicated or complex behavior, it starts to use the words stimulus, response, reinforcement in metaphoric ways. It loses the original strictness with which it defines these terms. So that is the overarching theme of Chomsky's review, where he takes each of these words or technical terms in the theory one by one. He examines them, takes them apart, and shows that either if you use the terms strictly, they explain only the most trivial of human behavior, and if you start to try to explain more complex verbal behavior, then the terms themselves become unscientific. They become used metaphorically, unscientifically. The example of stimulus control that is best known, I think, from the review is one where Skinner says, suppose you hear a piece of music and you identify it. You say Mozart. Or you see a painting and somehow you identify it as belonging to the Dutch school or style of painting and you say Dutch. Skinner thought of these as stimulus response behavior because he said that these verbal behaviors are under the control of extremely subtle properties of the physical object or event. That is, we cannot say what it is about that piece of music which lets you identify it as Mozart. But there is something in that piece of music. That is the stimulus which makes you say Mozart. Again, if you recognize a style of painting as Dutch, We are not able to say exactly what it is. These are extremely subtle properties of the stimulus event which provoke this response from you, touch. This is the example that Skinner gave. And Chomsky, he was young when he wrote this review, so he somewhat mischievously started asking, suppose instead of saying Dutch when we look at a painting, we said clashes with the wallpaper. You can imagine somebody saying that, you're interior decorating your house and this picture clashes with your wallpaper. Or you say, I thought you liked abstract work, because this is probably not abstract, I suppose. Or you can say, never saw it before. So he just thought up all these things that people actually can say when they see a painting. You know, tilted, hanging too low, beautiful, hideous. Remember our camping trip last summer? So Chomsky pointed out that the number of and variety of responses that a person can utter when he sees a painting, there's actually very little you can do to control this. Now, how do you then explain what any of these things which are being said when you see a painting? How do they arise? And he said, Skinner can only say that each of these responses is under the control of some other stimulus property of the physical object. In fact, I've tried to hint at some of these, you know. So if you say tilted, it is under the control of the property of the physical object that it is not hanging straight and you like things to hang straight. Now the problem with the theory now is you cannot identify the stimulus until you hear the response. In other words, a painting on a wall, it has properties that are intrinsic to it, it has properties that are extrinsic to it, like what its frame looks like, whether it's hanging straight, whether it clashes with the wallpaper or not. What the organism is paying attention to as the stimulus, you have no idea until the organism responds. Now, when you do this, therefore, the notion stimulus has lost all objectivity because you cannot identify the stimulus unless you see what the response is. So you become, your theory becomes circular. So if you look at a red chair and you say red, there must be a stimulus of redness, which is under the control of the chair. Or if you say chair, then the stimulus must be a property of chairness. On this view, the word stimulus, says Chomsky, has lost all objectivity. Stimuli are no longer part of the outside physical world. They are driven back into the organism. The talk of stimulus control simply disguises a complete retreat to mentalistic psychology, which is what Skinner was trying to keep out. The mind is not observable. He wanted to explain only behavior because behavior is observable. But now you find that this theory cannot account for anything which is really natural except by retreating into mentalistic psychology. This was the main critique that Chomsky made of verbal behavior. His second major critique of Skinner's verbal behavior was that Skinner adopts a view of sentence structure which is too simplistic. Now, to be fair to Skinner, this is not Skinner's problem. This was the problem of linguistics at that time. Skinner adopted the view of sentence structure that linguists had at that time. And this view was that a sentence consists of a grammatical frame on which you fit words. So, in Skinnerian language, the words which were content words like nouns, adjectives, and adverbs, and verbs, were called key responses. And these had to be put into a skeletal frame which was provided by the grammar. This was the idea of that time. So if you have a sentence like Sam rented a leaky boat, you can identify the content words here. Sam rent leaky boat. And there are elements in this sentence which are purely grammatical. For example, a, the indefinite article a, the ed on the verb which shows that it is a past event. These are grammatical elements. So the idea was the key responses, which are the content words, nouns, verbs, adjectives, adverbs, and so on, they are connected by grammatical words or the skeletal frame. They are composed into a sentence. So the process of composition is the process of ordering the elements and adding grammatical words or elements that express relations between these words. Now, this was the idea of how sentences are constructed at the time when Skinner was working. And as I said, Skinner simply adopted this into his theory, I think. I have a sneaking admiration for Skinner now, after I read Skinner, because I think he was being very strict with himself when he extended his theory to human behavior. And it was that which allowed Chomsky to criticize him. If Skinner had not done what he did, Chomsky would not have been able to criticize him. Anyway, the problems for this traditional view that sentences consist of lexical items placed in a grammatical frame were pointed out by Chomsky. And these are now common places of linguistic theory. The sentences that he constructed at that time have become part of linguistic lore now. The first thing he said was, take a sentence like sheep provide wool. These are all key responses in the Skinnerian frame of things. Sheep is a noun, provide is a verb, wool is again a noun. Sheep provide wool. There is no grammar that you can see. There are no grammatical elements that you can see. And yet, this is a sentence. On the other hand, if you put the words together in some other way, you don't get a sentence. Provide wool sheep is not a sentence. Will provide sheep is certainly not an understandable and meaningful sentence in English, and so on. So the grammatical frame here is completely hidden. And yet, we know when it exists and we know when it does not exist. That was the point he made. Then he suggested, look at the two sentences. Struggling artists can be a nuisance and marking papers can be a nuisance. As you can see or hear, those sentences have the same grammatical frame. Struggling artists, marking papers. Struggle, ink, mark, ink. Artists, papers. Can be common to both the sentences, a nuisance common to both the sentences. And yet, you understand these two sentences very differently, don't you? What does struggling artists mean? Struggling artists can be a nuisance. What does struggling artists mean? Artists who are struggling and they are a nuisance to other people. What does marking papers mean? It doesn't mean papers that are marking. It means for you or me to mark papers is a nuisance. So in one case, you're talking about artists who are a nuisance to others. In the other case, you're talking about an activity which you find a nuisance. This is an ambiguous sentence. But the grammatical frame in which it occurs, at least on the surface, it seems to be the same. So you can see that this is the beginning of Chomsky's ideas that sentences have a hidden structure, deep and surface structure and so on. The ideas that came up later, they are now coming into being, these ideas. Ambiguity arises when a sentence seems to have only one skeletal frame of grammar, but it has more than one interpretation, which means it has hidden grammar that we put into it, that we see in it. Later, Chomsky gave single sentences which are ambiguous, and these are again, as I said, very well known to all students of linguistics. Visiting relatives can be a nuisance. can you see that this sentence is ambiguous? To see the ambiguity, instead of can be, put a verb which agrees into it. So, let's change the sentence to read, visiting relatives are a nuisance. Visiting relatives are a nuisance. That means there are relatives who visit you and they're a nuisance, doesn't it? Now, change the verb again and say, visiting relatives is a nuisance. Visiting relatives is a nuisance. Now the relatives no longer visit. It is you who visit the relatives, and for you this activity is a nuisance. The reason visiting relatives can be a nuisance is ambiguous is that here you have a word like can, which is a modal as we call it, and there is no agreement with the subject. So you don't know whether the subject is an activity or a set of relatives. All right? Similarly, now you will be able to do the second example on your own. Flying planes can be dangerous. You can see that you can think of flying planes as an activity which is dangerous. So the sentence is disambiguated when you say flying planes is dangerous. It is dangerous to fly planes. On the other hand, you can think of flying planes as planes that are flying. So then, if you wanted to use the verb be in that sentence, you would say flying planes are dangerous, because planes is plural and you would say are dangerous. Flying planes are dangerous refers to planes that fly. Flying planes is dangerous refers to the activity of flying planes. Now, all this grammar, if you have been understanding and agreeing with what I've been saying, all this grammar is in your mind. Because on the surface, flying planes can be dangerous is just one sentence. At the time when Chomsky introduced these kinds of sentences into linguistic theory, theorization, before that, the gestalt psychologists had already put into the domain of psychology the ambiguous figure. So, we are now showing you two figures which are ambiguous. Can you look at them and see if you can see in what ways you can understand these figures? What are these figures showing you? Take a moment to look. Look at the figure on the left. Have you been able to see what it is? I'll give you the name of this figure, and that will probably help you to see what it is. It's called the duck rabbit. The duck rabbit. Why is it both a duck and a rabbit? Now you can see the ears of the rabbit can be seen as the beak of the duck in this figure. It's been cleverly drawn so that you can see it as a duck which is looking to the left, in which case the long things on the left are its beak. Or you can look at it as a rabbit which is looking upwards, I think, in which case its ears are horizontal. Its ears are sticking out of its head. I'm sure you've seen the ambiguity by now. What about the figure on the right? That's called the old man and the mouse. The old man and the mouse. I'm sure you can see it now. Can you see an old man who's wearing spectacles and he's got a very large nose? And now you look for the mouse. Yes, the spectacles become the mouse's ears. The man's nose is now the mouse's face. I'll give you two more of these figures just to have some fun. These are very well known. Have you seen these ones before? The one on the left, can you see that it can be seen as an old woman? Yes, with a large nose and a protruding chin. Now, can you look at it as a young woman who's got her face turned away from you? And what was the old woman's mouth is something now at her neck. It is a kind of necklace or something she's wearing. This is called the mother-in-law, daughter-in-law figure. The figure on the right, perhaps more people have seen this than any of the other figures. This is called the Peter Paul goblet. And this is a very easy ambiguity to resolve. It is what we call a figure ground reversal. That is, if you see the background as black, what do you see as the figure? The figure is a goblet, a cup. If you see the background as white, then you see two faces in profile, right? So you reverse what is the background and what is the foreground, and you see two different things. It's called the Peter Paul goblet. Now, ambiguous figures, why are they of interest to a theory of psychology and how we see things? They are of interest because at the time when they were first invented and shown by the Gestalt psychologists, people had a very simple theory of how we see things. They thought we see something, we keep an image of it in our mind, and we match the next thing we see to our mental image. So you've seen a rabbit before, so when you see a rabbit again, you match it to your mental image of a rabbit. Now the problem is with ambiguous figures, you've never seen these figures before, first of all. Secondly, how can you interpret the same figure in more than one way? Now, as we went through the ambiguous figures, you saw that I was drawing attention to how you actually arrive at an interpretation of the ambiguous figure. You analyze the figure in such a way that something is first a nose and next it becomes an ear. So you interpret the lines of the figures according to some kind of visual grammar that you have, and only after that do you recognize what it is. So ambiguous figures therefore challenge the very simple idea of how we see what we see. What Chomsky did for language is a similar thing. He showed that we do not recognize a sentence simply because we've heard it before, because we can recognize ambiguity in sentences, which means we must be parsing sentences in some way. Parsing means applying rules of analysis to that sentence. We know that there are rules for how to combine words or morphemes into phrases and sentences, because we saw that a sentence can be infinitely long, and that's because we can apply rules of composition to words and morphemes to put them in sentences. These combinatorial rules are what we learn when we learn language. Now, therefore, it is this combinatorial property of language that gives it its creativity. Every sentence we speak is freshly combined, but it is not combined into completely surprising ways. It doesn't have to be new in the sense that I shouldn't say what you said. It is new in the sense it is not something which is a repetition of what I've heard before, but it uses the rules of sentence composition to compose the sentence. In that sense, all language use is creative. It is rule-governed creativity. You'll find much more about this notion in the E lesson. I have not been able to speak here about the creativity of the raga in Indian classical music, which I have argued is a similar rule-governed creativity. So if you look at the E lesson, maybe you can think about these things. Thank you very much.